The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition. I know if you're watching the video version of this podcast, I haven't done the same joke I've done for every other masked wrestler by wearing a mask at the start, but I am joined in this edition by, from El Bridgerton, Soldato. Welcome to the show.
Hello, pleased to be here.
So, but I get to reveal on this podcast properly that I do have a little lucha tattoo now, so... There we go.
Oh, lovely. I like it. Very nice. It looks like Falcon's mask.
Well, I went just for like a random one. I didn't want to... The one I liked was a Ramesses mask, but Blue Thunder uses it in WrestleZone. And I thought, I go there too often for me to get that because I'll look a little bit too keen if I go, Blue Thunder, look, I've got your mask on. So I went for a random one and give it Iron Brew colours. So it's Iron Brucha.
Iron Brucha. I like it. Very good.
I'm hoping for that Iron Brew sponsorship. That's what I'm aiming for.
We can all dream.
So the first question is always the same. So it's your standard wrestler podcast question. I'm just turning up the volume of my headphones here a little bit. What was the moment that got you into wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked?
So I don't really know. I've probably watched wrestling for too long to know the answer to that one. I can remember being 4 years old, your talk. I'm probably a bit older than people may think. So you're talking Hogan Warrior days. And it's just something that was always on. I loved it. It was remember when Sky had the kind of cable box? So it was a kind of cable box on Sky One. And I would watch wrestling, then I would try and beat up my big sister, who 9 times out of 10 would win. Meanwhile, I'd have my mum, my dad, my gran telling me how fake it was. That's kidology, and I would go ballistic. It's not fake. It's not fake. So I watched it, as I say, for years. And then I think when I was 5 or 6, WWF at the time came to the SECC in Glasgow. I think it was a European Rampage tour. And my biggest memory from that was The Undertaker, and he was the largest human being that I think I'd ever seen. I think I probably think I'd ever seen. So yes, it's from day dot, I've always been into it.
Yeah, I remember that. Well, I don't remember the cable days because I started that at Tudera, so I was a little bit later on. But definitely when you see them at the live shows, Undertaker was one, Kane. I got to see the Great Khali once, and he is a ridiculously sized human being. I was like 3 rows back, and I was just going, "Holy, what is that?" And it is. So, early favourites then, you said you started watching about Warrior and Hogan, and of course Undertaker you've mentioned. Was there anyone else that kind of stood out to you?
Roddy Piper at the time, he was either from Maryhill or Partick, depending on what day of the week it was and what show it was. But being Scottish, I was a bit of a rowdy Roddy Piper fan. The Bulldogs as well, I loved the British Bulldog, Dairy Boy. I loved it. Very, very slight memories of the tag team. And then, obviously, when Davey Boy was himself, I loved him as well. I thought he was fantastic.
It's really that British contingent. It's like, oh, these are our guys. Even though we found out very much later that Roddy wasn't. But he was enough. He was Scottish enough for us to cling on to him. We still do, I think, a little bit. If you wear a kilt, you're ours for life.
That's right.
So yeah, so a lot of the early ones, and did you ever have a lapse break, or was you just constant? Was that you wrestling?
I kind of drifted off and on. I drifted kind of away. Monday Night Wars happened, and then towards the end of that, I was finding my kind of drinking on the streets and girls phase. That's kind of the drinking on the streets has ended, but. So yeah, I kind of drifted away from it quite a bit there. Kind of watched it if it was on, but it's not something I would pay a lot of attention to. If there was a big show on, say a WrestleMania or a SummerSlam, I would try and catch it, but it wasn't something that fussed me too much. Kind of before that phase, WCW was quite a big thing for me. I think it's because when I was at school, in a second, I'll mute that. When I was at school, I was always one of the smaller guys. A lot of people will say you're still one of the smaller guys, but I loved all the kind of the lucha stuff, the high flying, the likes of kind of Billy Kidman, Rey Mysterio. Then I kind of fell away from it for quite a few years. It was kind of well into my 20s that I picked it back up, really, and started watching it more often.
So that's pretty well, can you part of your backstory then, that these cruiserweights were the guys that you were really drawn to WCW anyway, and then when around about when you were watching WWF, they didn't have this. That was WCW's kind of bonus. It had all these cool cruiserweights guys. I mean, WWF had them as well, but not on this. They weren't used in the same way. They weren't given like a platform. Yeah. They were just part of the show, like your S.A. Rios and your Hardys and all that kind of stuff. And then, so when you came back then, it must have been very different if it was post-Attitude Era. Would have been a bit more focused on smaller guys around about then as well.
Yeah.
When you came back to it, was there anyone that was obvious one probably that suggested from other people be Rey Mysterio and stuff like that? But was there anyone else that kind of went, oh, this is my guy?
Well, I knew who Rey Mysterio was, obviously. John Cena had kind of not long broken in, I think, at this time, so we're kind of quite into the Ruthless Aggression era. I loved the Hurricane. I thought his work was amazing. Shane Helms, I thought his stuff was really good. It had the kind of the comedy aspect to it, but his timing was spot on. His moveset was pretty cool. Everything was quite cool about him. Who else? I loved X-Pac. Obviously, I've always loved X-Pac. From his days as a 1-2-3 kid all the way through, I've always thought he was a really good worker. And then, kind of, yeah, I would say Cena, although everyone kind of was leaning towards hating him at that point, I thought he was kind of cool. And then,
I can figure out when. So 2003-2005, roundabout that kind of sweet spot, which is again perfect for this whole backstory, because that bang in the middle of that was SmackDown 6, and you had the cruiserweights being really a focal point. You had Ultimo Dragon coming in, you had Chavo Guerrero, a lot different than 99 WWF. It was more focused on just high flying.
The styles were because initially when I watched WWF years ago, there was one style match. There was two styles. There was your standard wrestling match and there was a tag match. But now you had the kind of the Japanese influence, you had the Mexican influence, the British influence, a big melting pot. And I think it made the shows overall a lot more enjoyable. It made it more of a variety show, so there's always going to be something for everyone.
Absolutely. I mean, they've kind of continued that to this day. I mean, of course, there's the vocal minority or the majority that have switched off, but there's the minority that just hates everything. But there's like that group of folk in the middle that will watch a show and go, oh, I didn't like this. I like this. This is why I'm still going to watch it. It's got, that melting pot is a perfect analogy for it. So we're into the early 2000s. When did you start to decide, right, I enjoy watching this. This is quite good. I'm going to try it myself. Well, how did you get to that point?
I never thought it was a big thing in the UK, in Scotland anyway. I remember years ago I seen kind of the NWA UK Hammerlock kind of thing was going on. But that was down south. I didn't pay much attention to that. So I joined the Army at 18. So I kind of travelled about and done a bit here, a bit there. Actually, when I was in my teens, we skipped into a tribute show in the Kelvin Hall, which was really funny. Stone Cold Steve Austin had a shot back and sides. Thinking back now, it was horrendous, but at the time, they popped. A couple of young guys that kind of were WCW, WWF fans were popped. But then coming back into it, I think there was a show, it was a Pride Wrestling show in Bridgeton. Obviously, that's where it's twinned with Elbridge Town. So I went to one of them and I thought, that's really good. I've always been quite athletic. So it generated a wee idea in my head. I didn't act on it. I went to a couple of other shows. I went to kind of the biggest one that sticks out was the ICW, the surprise Fergal Devitt one.
All right, okay.
I think that's Still Smoking or something. Still Smoking too, maybe. Not too sure of the name, but
yeah.
I went to that, and then I didn't actually consider taking it up until, believe it or not, I was 29. GPWA were advertising in the asylum in Glasgow. And I thought, well, it's now or never. I might as well give this a try before I'm 30. So I went along, I was in the very first intake. I think I'm one of the only ones that are still there from the very first intake. I think there's maybe two or three of us at most. And I've been there ever since. So it's been, what, six, coming up on 7 years now?
Six. It depends if you're counting last year, but I did notice you had a couple of matches in 2020, so I suppose, unfortunately, you have to count it. So you've seen a bit of ICW and seen some of the guys that you're going in to train, well, that was going to coach you. I was curious when I've had a couple of guests that didn't see any wrestling or any Scottish wrestling, saw the flyer for GPWA, went in, and they're just seeing five guys or whoever, however many coaches are there that day, and they're just the guys that are coaching you. Whereas you would have seen Jester bleeding everywhere. You would have seen BT Gunn like murdering people with chops and the likes. And then you walk in. I mean, suppose at 29, you're a bit more mature. You're like, oh, you know that it's not real, kind of thing. But was there a little bit of an intimidation factor when you went in and saw all these guys you'd watch wrestle?
I had very kind of vague memories of, I went to the same school as Wolfgang and BT Gunn. I think I was in the year above Wolfie and 2 years above BT. I was actually in the same year as BT Gunn's big sister. So I had kind of vague, I kind of knew them but didn't know them. I knew their people that they knew and things like that. So there wasn't really any trepidation, and at the time I worked in the Corinthian Casino, so I had kind of spoken to Chester on nights out and stuff. There wasn't any massive trepidation about it. I knew that the guys were really experienced, they were really good at what they do. That's one of the things that pushed me towards going there, is that if you're going to learn from people, you want to learn from people that have been there and walked the walk, and could, rather than can just talk the talk, and all five of them at the time definitely could.
And did you find that because you were in the army that you kind of took to the procedure's not the word, not even the regiment, but the, what's the word? The, when you do everything in order.
Oh, all right. Can I regimented?
Regiment, yeah. Were you kind of prepared for that? So, I mean, a lot of guys would have been like, oh, this is a struggle, but you being in the army, you would have been like, ah, this is, I did this. I know how to do this. I just follow the orders and do it in that order.
That pretty much, yeah. So when it was coming to things like talking through your basics, like a lockup, a forward roll, a backwards roll, I'm quite athletic and I've always kept a reasonable level of fitness. So yeah, talking and the way that the coaches break everything down, it's step by step, so that it's really easy to understand and simple to understand. And yet it's kind of, as an army thing, it's drilled in you to follow orders to the T. So yeah, I picked that up quite quickly, I think.
So I said the army stuff, and you say you kept yourself kind of in shape and a good level of fitness. Did you do anything else outside of that kind of genuine, like martial arts or football or something that kind of just kept that, your stamina ticking over, or were you just a gym head?
I go to the gym. I try and train at the gym as much as possible, but I am a boot camp instructor. I've been doing that for 11 years now. That is teaching military type fitness to civilians out in parks. So I've worked for the same company now for 11 years. So doing that keeps your kind of your cardio game on point as well, and can keeps your health and fitness in general up there quite high.
And discipline. That's also keeps that in check, because of course you're in charge, and then you show respect to your higher up, and they do that to you, and you do it to them when you're training. Was there anything you found particularly difficult when you started? Was there anything, because you said you could do the roles, forward roles, kind of keep it broken down into what you're taught, but was there anything that you thought this might be not this bit might not be the bit for me?
I can't really think of anything that I thought was overly everything. I'm not saying that I think everything was easy, because it really, really wasn't. The first session that you hit the ropes, you've been training quite a while before you hit the ropes. We must have hit the ropes 100, 200 times, man. That was spicy. Obviously bumps. Not that I didn't find them easy. It's obviously it's tough on your body. A few training seminars that we had some guests in were really challenging in regards to the fitness. We had Joe and Mark Coffey in. Don't think it was long off their kind of Japan 01 stuff. So they done a Japanese type seminar with us, and we weren't that far into training. And that was, that was a different level at the time. But in regards to kind of the GPWA structure training, there's nothing that I found overly difficult. No, I think I can attribute that to, as I say, having a kind of decent level, a base level of fitness.
And where did you find, how long was it between starting that and before you found out you were actually getting to do a bit of wrestling? I assume it was a gala. Cage Match says it was ICW Square Go, so I don't think it was that, but it was probably a gala or a show before then. So when did you find out that, you're going to get your first match?
We had a couple of weeks' notice. It was a show in Deniston. GPWA, I'm not sure if Wrestling Experience Scotland have taken it over, but GPWA used to run a show up at Wood Street in Deniston. And it was a tag match for my first match. We'd actually done two matches on the same day. So I tagged with Kez Evans, and we were against CS Rose and Flex Hunter, both guys who unfortunately no longer wrestle. So we had an afternoon show in Deniston, and then we had an evening show in Ayr for PWE, Pro Wrestling Elite. So that was my first kind of two shows, and they were on the same day.
So that's definitely throw into the deep end. So just to wind back then, you told you get your first match. How long before that did you kind of have the idea of wearing the mask and having that as your character?
Yeah, well, it wasn't even initially my idea. It was the coaches. I think it was kind of Wolfie and BT, maybe Jester as well. They had said that there's a bit of an opening in the marketplace. There's not very many masked wrestlers, and there's not many masked wrestlers that can do it and do it well. And it seemed to fit my style. I seemed to actually like to jump about the ropes and flip about and do that kind of thing. Seemed to gravitate more towards the lucha style. So from there, they came up with the kind of, why don't you try wearing the mask? But it wasn't until the actual day of the show that I came up with the names. The day of my first show that I came up with my name.
And does it mean anything in particular, or was it just, this sounds good, go for that?
It means soldier.
Well, that absolutely makes sense now. we've discussed your backstory before that. Yeah, that seems very fitting. So the mask itself, then, from looking at it, it's very Rey Mysterio inspired. But was there anything in particular that you wanted to put into the mask to represent yourself or to just make it look cool? And how did you go about getting the mask?
Well, the cross that I've got on my forehead, as I tell people this all the time, it's not actually a ripoff of Rey Mysterio's. I've got a tattoo on my chest that I got when I was maybe 18, 19 years old, and it's a cross. If you've ever seen me wrestle, you'll have seen the cross. So I wanted to get that on my forehead. I've got it also. I wear that the same cross or a similar cross on my tights. This wasn't my first mask. My first mask was an eBay number. It was, there was a wrestler in Mexico. His name was Shocker. And so I had a black and gold version of a Shocker mask, and it was like a thick foam, and it was absolutely murder to wear during that match because it was so warm. So my own mask, I got a design from Bear Hug. Bear Hug Designs are a company that design kind of masks and gear and like that, and they're really good. And I took that design to eLucha, which is a company, I think they are a Mexican company. They run from the US. And I gave them my design, and they made it up for me, got it sent over.
Shocker, that's the name I haven't heard in a while. He used to wrestle in TNA. Remember him wrestling in TNA, but without the mask, because I think he just lost it just before he debuted in TNA. But no, the foam, that's, I've got a couple of replica masks, because I'm a sado that has that sort of thing when it comes to wrestling merch. But yeah, the thickness of the foam, you don't really expect, because if anyone's watched the previous episode I did with Lucha DS, and I think I did the same joke with Talon Jr., I wore the mask, and it is so hot, it is so thick, it's ridiculous. I think I only had it on for 5 minutes because I was overheating. And I was like, how do you wrestle in it? But of course, if it's a professionally made mask, it's going to be a little bit thinner, a little bit more breathable. It's not going to be a replica for idiots like me to wear.
The thicker ones are good for absorbing punches, right enough. But apart from that,
So wrestling in the mask, I've spoken to a couple of luchas in the past, including Lucha DS and the like, and I always ask about like how much more you have to be aware of wrestling in a mask, because of course you've knocked out a little bit more of your peripheral vision doing that. Your hearing as well, that gets dulled down. So when you got the mask, the Shocker mask, did you do a little bit extra training just to get used to it? What extra things did you realize you had to be more aware of wearing the mask?
Yeah, I took it to training for quite a few, maybe 6-7 weeks before I had a show, just to get used to the feel of it and the extra kind of panache that you need to bring to the table with it. So as you say, it affects your kind of your peripheral vision, your hearing, your breathing also, because it can affect your, if it's a bit tight around the throat, which it needs to be, otherwise another wrestler's going to grab it and rip it off, which a few have tried. I think Lucha DS has a few masks ripped. So yeah, it can affect quite a lot. It's more than you give it credit for. You don't think it would be quite as a burden as it is.
And then, you add a little bit of extra because of the panache bit of it. You blacken up your eyes as well. So it's not that you wouldn't think that would add an extra layer of heat, but it would, because of course you're wearing face paint. So how warm is it in that first couple of times? I suppose you're a bit more used to it now, but when you actually got a proper wrestling match in front of a crowd, you've got a mask on, you've got the makeup underneath as well, face paint underneath as well. Were you surprised by the heat that was on your head?
As far as I can remember, at the Denniston show, we didn't have a lighting rig or anything. So it was hot. But then when we got to Pro Wrestling Elite, it was in Ayrtown Hall, and they had the lighting set up, and oh my god, that the additional heat that the lighting on the ring gives you is unbelievable. Back then I didn't wear the black face paint underneath the mask. So that helped, but wow, it just adds that extra wee bit again. So it's hard enough, but then when you add the heating and the lighting on top of it, oh.
it's not handy that you're in a black mask as well, which is just soaks up all that heat.
It just absorbs it, yeah.
It's not an ideal place to be. So, like I said, your debut, I've got down, according to the Germans at Cage Match, was the Square Go. 2016, Nathaniel Square Go. So this must have been not long after making your debut for GPWA. So that's a pretty big debut. I mean, it's Square Go match itself, so some may say you were there to make up the numbers. But what was it like getting into an ICW ring with a crowd that it's an ICW crowd? So they're not the most forgiving if they don't know who you are. Yeah. So what was that like?
It was incredible. Absolutely incredible. I think there was 1,200, maybe 1,250, something like that. I think it was a sold out show at the Barras. And yeah, it was incredible. And I thought, fantastic, it's exposure. I thought it would just be in and out, job done. But no, I was in for a while and I got to do a wee bit of bits and bobs with people, which I really enjoyed. Done a bit with Andy Wilde, a bit with Joe Coffey, a bit with Dave Mastiff, even kind of maybe predicted the future a wee bit when I had a wee bit of tag action with Solar. Done a bit of double team stuff with him, yeah.
So, yeah, a lot of big guys then that you got to either do a bit of your high-flying stuff or just being flown. He's quite really... It's the bits people remember, and then of course you're getting quite the Rumble experience because you're in the PWE Elite Rumble as well in 2016. Yeah. So these are all you're all the ring with like huge names and definitely Scottish wrestling. So it's even if you've got them for a second, like say like Andy Wilde and Dave Mastiff, even in the ring with them for a minute, you probably soaked up so much, and not just the heat, but soaked up so much knowledge in that moments, but. The match, one of the matches that first sprung up to me was May 2016, was GPWA, and it was a Zero-G Championship match. It was yourself against one of your trainers, Lionheart.
Yeah.
So Lionheart would have been, in while he was champion, he was really getting this huge character over as either the fanny or the hero. He was really, he was pretty much one of the biggest names in the country, easily.
Yeah.
What was it like in the ring with one of your coaches and knowing that this is a title match as well, and it's quite a big deal. So what was that like?
It was a big deal, and I was so thankful to be put in that position. I had never wrestled Lionheart before, even in training. It showed me things. I'd watched plenty of his work, so I knew exactly what to expect, and It was fast paced, heavy hitting stuff. It was really good. I loved it. I learned so much from it.
But yeah, for a guy his height as well, he was deceptively so sleek and fast and could match it with you. So that was probably one of your biggest tests early on was trying to keep up with someone like a Lionheart.
Yeah.
Of course, he didn't walk away with the title that night.
No.
Much to pay, so that was probably one of your biggest matches at the time. And I'm just again looking through all these matches that you had. Not long afterwards, you were in the ring with an our coach, Jack Jester, BCW. So it's BCW, so it's a new company. I mean, when you're saying wrestling ICW and PWE, of course they've got quite strong ties to GPWA anyway. So BCW is kind of your first trip outside of the ICW bubble.
Yeah.
Again, it has huge crowds for BCW. So you've already done the Barrowlands. So BCW crowds probably not much. It's just a kid friendly version of the same size of crowd. But when did you find that? Because you were in the mask, you said you had to learn a bit more about like what you had to do. Did you find connecting with the crowd any difficulty, or did you have to research anyone in particular to try and make sure that your movements were larger than life because your mask covering your face?
I watched as much kind of Mexican kind of AAA lucha libre stuff as possible, and I tried not to watch the wrestling as such. I tried to watch reactions. I watched their hand movements, their facial features, or their eye movements more than anything else. And their mouth movements, because you can't. People always call your face your kind of your money maker. Wearing a mask, you lose some of that. So I try and connect in other ways. So I'll maybe use my hands. I'll use my body. what I've started doing, I wouldn't say recently, over the last few years, is I'll find someone in the front row, normally a kid, and I'll focus on them. And if I can get that kid to cheer for me, he'll get that wee group around them cheering, and then it'll kind of ripple out like waves. So that's what I try and do now. But it took me a long time to learn that, pick that up.
Kids are the perfect kind of place to go, especially as a mass wrestler, because you look like a superhero. That's pretty much it. And like I say, we've drawn comparisons to like Rey Mysterio, of course, because he's the biggest name in lucha wrestling, even though he's not technically as much a lucha libre wrestler, but he is still a big name because of the mask. Did you fight? So that leads us to March 2017, which is Lucha Mania. So we're not even just over a year in, or so into your wrestling, and you're going to this event in Wales. So again, out of the country. You're with Lucha DS in a tag team. So were you just kind of thrown together yourself in Lucha, or was Lucha contact you, contact him, going, right, we've got this opportunity, do you want to come along? How did that get set up?
Lucha contacted me. Lucha is a marketing genius. So he puts himself out there and he markets himself in different ways. So I don't know how he found Exposure Entertainment. I know that Jester had worked with them previously and travelled down with some GPWA guys before I had been down. But he found out that they were running a lucha-only show, and he tied in with the promoter and told him that he would bring down some luchadors. And that's pretty much how that happened, which I thought was fantastic.
So was this the kind of catalyst then to Lucha Scotland?
It was, yeah, it was. I think the wee tiny bit that me and Solar done at the Square Go was maybe a wee preempt to it. And then me and Lucha tagging, that kick-started the idea. It was all Lucha DS's baby. I'll give him credit where it's due. It was him that decided, right, there's four of us, we all wear masks. Rather than compete against each other for spots, why don't we try and fight to get spots on the same show, tag, etc., etc.?
Yeah, when I was listening to your chat with Stephen Louch, Tuck of the Draw.
I don't remember much of that one.
You were quite rowdy on the four years. I don't know if it was just the excitement in the air that you were all getting to have a chat, or probably some liquid beverages that were assisting. But yeah, it was quite a rabble at times between the four years and Stephen trying to maintain some sort of control on the whole situation as well. But so it was yourself. So we'll dot back and forth between your wrestling and this as well. So it's yourself, Lucha DS, Robbie Solar, and Falcon. So at the time, I could probably name maybe two more that wrestled in Scotland regularly in masks. So it was pretty much the core mask contingent of Scottish wrestling, even though Falcon was really just doing reckless shows and pop up here and there at the time. Once this big group chat happened between the four years, Lucha in charge, getting everything put in places. So again, not even just over a year into your career, and you're now part of this big conglomerate of mass wrestlers. Do you think it was like just mad? What was your thoughts on Lucha Scotland in general once it started up?
I thought when Lucha DS had kind of explained his thought process and what he wanted to do and how he wanted it to work, I thought, right, straight away I'm in, because this sounds pretty cool. It's not very often that you'll find more than one masked wrestler on a card. So that there normally will be one masked wrestler on every card, but there won't be two, if you get me. So given that there's maybe only so many shows, if any show only ever wants one mask wrestler, that kind of limits your audience and limits where you can work or what time, etc., etc. So given he proposed the idea that we work together and then maybe we all work a show, like for instance Big Massive booked us in a four-way, which was good fun. It just gets us more exposure on shows. It gets people more used to seeing more than one masked wrestler on a show, and it shows promoters that it does work. It gets the crowd get behind masked wrestlers straight away, and yet I think we've definitely showed that we can work with more than one on a show.
I do have that noted, the Lucha War in 2019, which of course you won.
Yeah.
As well, so I don't know if that makes you the best masked wrestler in the country, but
some may say
definitely in that moment the facts are there. You beat them all, you beat all the rest of them, so you must be the better ones. So like I said, we'll dot back and forth between Lucha DS and all that kind of stuff. So I just want to come to back to 2017. You made your Target debut, and again championship match, you know. Mm-hmm. Just Oh, no, it wasn't. It was actually the current Target Wrestling High Octane Division Champion.
Yeah,
it was
yeah,
a title
yeah.
match, but now he's the champion, Damon Havoc. Year 2017, you were just popping up all over the place. Reckless Event as well against fellow GPWA standout Thatcher Wright. You had a couple matches with him.
Me and Thatcher had about five or six matches in a really short period of time, which was really good to work, because we made sure we didn't work the same match more than once. So it was really good fun working with him, because I know him well. We've obviously trained together. So it was good to get to work with someone that you know inside out.
I bet that reaction you were getting when you were coming out as well. Because, I mean, not just because you got the mask and the big superhero look, and then you're against Thatcher Wright, who...
He's phenomenal.
He's very easy to hate for many reasons, but mainly the book.
I think she wouldn't stop punching. Some have said I've heard that before.
So that must have been like, not like a WrestleMania, but when you come out, it must have just been an absolute roar, even in the smaller units for Reckless Intent. Must be something else. But 2017 also had you in a match with then ICW champion Joe Coffey.
Yes.
So, you've wrestled Lionheart, Jester. Oh, you've wrestled Lionheart for a Zero G Championship. Wrestled Jack Jester because he's one of the biggest names. And then you're in the ring with World Heavyweight Champion Joe Coffey. And like you said, he's with his training itself, that from like Japan and all the on the like. That must have been a tough day in the office. Was it a tough one?
It was a tough match. It was hard hitting, and I gave as good as I got, I think. I think if you go back and watch that match, I put his head through the wall of the asylum, which he apologised for afterwards. He offered to pay to get it repaired, because his head literally went through the drywall. That was a really good match. I really enjoyed that. Joe, from obviously he's the champion, and we knew that he was going to be on the show. He was announced for the show before it was the kind of the card was put out. So no one knew who he was going to be facing, or whether it would even be one of the students, or whether it would be another coach, or so on and so forth. So when Red Lightning, who put the show together, gave me that opportunity, I thought it was fantastic, and I was so grateful for it. I learned so much from that interaction. It was about a 12 to 15 minute match. But I learned so much from that brief interaction with Joe as well. He's such a talented worker. He just oozes professionalism inside and outside of the ring. So it was such a great opportunity to work with him.
So, like I say, you're the first one of the first names coming out of GPWA, and you wrestled pretty much most of at least most of the heels anyway, GPWA side of things. Was there anyone in particular that you were like it was just an easy day in the office, if you're wrestling like Kez or CS Rose or Ravy Davey, was there anyone in particular that you were like getting in the ring with going, this is bliss, this is just, I could do this with my eyes closed?
Sam Barber. SBX, the Sam Barber Experience. I think I've only wrestled him at a show once. Again, that was for Pro Wrestling Elite, but I've worked with him in training. I continue to work with him in training just now. We train together still to this day, and his work's really good. His character works really good, but once he's actually in the ring, he knows what he's doing. He knows how he throws weight about. He knows exactly what his moveset is and what he wants to do, and because we've trained together so long, he knows my moveset as well. So it's we could probably get in and wrestle quite a good match without having any kind of conversation before it whatsoever.
So speaking of that, of course, when we wrestle like the bigger guys like your Joe Coffey and what have you, of course, to them it's his old hat. They know what they're doing, they know what they're about, and what they could bring to the table. For you putting together a match, is it a case of at that time were you still just a yes, sir, we can do this, I can bring this in, and trying to put it all together, or did you ever find that a guy like Joe would just go, right, that's fine, this is the finish, we'll just go out there?
When I wrestled Jester, he asked me, give me three things that you do. I told him that, and then he said, right, okay, I'll tell you when to do them. Away we go. And we done exactly that, and it turned out a great match. With Joe, the conversation went along the lines of, talk to me about your moveset. What do you like to do? What do you feel comfortable with? Have you seen what I do? We'll squeeze this in. We ad-libbed quite a bit in the middle of it as well, which was great. It just kind of, obviously with him being much more experienced, I was got mouth shut, ears open, and followed his lead, which he leads very, very well. And I was pleasantly surprised at how the match went, considering we did ad-lib quite a bit of it.
That's the bit that always scares me. I mean, I've said many times I would never be a wrestler just because I don't physically think I would handle it, and I don't want to, which is the biggest point. I don't want to. But yeah, that bit always kind of, like, I fluster very easily. And if someone came up to me and went, right, we're going to have a match, what can you do? Right, I'll tell you when. I'll be like, whoa, no. Can you a little bit more than that, please?
Yeah.
I think I'm the Randy Savage, DDP. Not that I'm saying I would wrestle like them, but I would need a little bit of a list. So here's some bullet points. I'll work from there. But how did you find? How did you find that? And of course, again, we're going back to your military background, but it's just a rinse and repeat. It's taking the orders, do what you're told. And that's it. So did you ever find yourself get flustered in the ring, or because you were being trained not just in wrestling but elsewhere to just do what you're told in this order, did you find it quite, not easy, but did you find it quite logical to work through, and you didn't find yourself getting flustered at all?
Yeah, I think I've never thought about it that way and kind of related it to my military background, but yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. It also makes sense that if things do go wrong, I don't really lose my cool or get too fussed about it, because there's a military saying, it's Murphy's Laws of War, and that no plan survives the first round. So the first round is in the first bullet. No plan survives the first bullet. So everything goes wrong, no matter how much you plan it. It's all about how you react to that.
Absolutely. I mean, at the end of the day, the only people that know a match goes properly wrong will be the guys wrestling it.
Because
as long as, like you say, as long as you keep your cool, then the crowd's not going to know. We're not going to know. I mean, there is odd times where I'll watch a match and go, oh, that went wrong. But generally, unless there's a reaction afterwards, you don't really get it. You don't really know. So, yeah, you're making your mark everywhere. One of the few luchadors or masked wrestlers, at least in the country. You make your discovery debut in the Derby. I've got it written down here. So again, another battle royal to make a mark for yourself. What was it like getting into discovery? Because I keep hearing it's got this great reputation. It's got a great atmosphere. But what are your memories of making your disco debut?
That was really good. I met a lot of guys there for the first time who I'd never met before, the likes of Kuma. I'd never met him before. Such a really, really nice guy. Honestly, I couldn't say enough about him. Such a nice guy. The backstage atmosphere was incredible. Really good. Everyone was just relaxed. Everyone was chilled out. Everyone was in a great mood. The weather had been horrendous. There was blizzards. I was driving through from Glasgow with Ravy Davy and Dickie Divers. And we were worried that we were going to actually get there. but just because of the time. There was a few people that had didn't pitch up until halfway through the show because the weather was abysmal. And then me and Davey hot footing it back through the central belt at 11 o'clock and the drive in snow at 80 miles an hour was a good experience as well.
It sounds like such a random car as well. Yourself, Ravy Davey, and Dickie Divers.
it was a good laugh. It was really good fun.
The match stuff, so we were able to at least like get a couple moments in like you did with Square Go. Were you able to make a mark a little bit?
Yeah, definitely. I worked with a few, there was a few guys in that match as well from kind of up north, WrestleZone type places that I'd never wrestled before, I'd never met before. So it was good kind of interacting with those guys, networking with them, and then doing a wee bit in the ring with them as well. So it's great. I'm quite a kind of networking guy. I like to get to know people. I like to have friends in all different places. I don't like to be cliche. So it's good to get to know people from outside your home area, maybe outside where you're comfortable.
I was checking, when I was doing my research, I was scrolling through pictures and I saw you were in the derby with Sean Johnson. Of course, that was up in WrestleZone. And if anyone knows me, they know that if you mention WrestleZone, you're right here. You're in my heart because I love that company so much. But that networking bit, of course, you would have had that yourself. But of course, I'm guessing Lucha would have been there as well. Lucha in back of your head going, right, this is something we can get together. We can get a couple guys up there. We can do this as well and get working as well. But I think WrestleZone's actually just lost their one mask guy. Blue Thunder's just retired. So there's a spot. There's a mask guy spot. I mean, otherwise they've just got the Sistos, which isn't really a spot. It's just a really weird fever dream. If you ever see the Sistos wrestling, it's just, they're called the Tangerine Dream. I don't know if you've ever seen them, but they're just all in orange with an orange and black mask, and they come out to popcorn. It is weird, but no, there's a spot open for a mask wrestler.
It's somewhere I'd love to work. As wrestlers, I'd love to work up there with those guys. There's a lot of talent up there.
And it's very kid friendly and family orientated, and they would buzz for. I should say there is also Super Executioner. I couldn't believe I missed out on our masked wrestler, but generally he's reserved for the smaller shows. So like I say, there's a spot open in WrestleZone, I'm sure. But so as far as companies go, again, you 2018 was another great year for you because you end up in Hope as well, and winning your first title.
I did, yeah.
Defeating Drew Parker, who of course is doing phenomenal things in Japan now with all deathmatch stuff. So even though it was your reign maybe lasted minutes, you could still say that you defeated Drew Parker.
I was a two-time champion. I think I defeated No Fun Done as well that same night, I think. Or did he beat me? I won it twice that night.
I definitely have. I mean, again, I'm relying on Cage Match for my answers here, but definitely I've got you defeating Drew Parker and then him defeating you as well. But when it comes to the titles, I don't know if you're a title guy. If you're, I noticed you did take plenty of time to snap some pictures with the belt before you had to lose it. Because why wouldn't you?
Exactly.
But what was it like getting your first belt, even though it was for minutes?
Yeah, it's, in the grand scheme of things, it's a prop, but it's always a nice feeling to get that picture up with a bit of gold on your shoulder. It's not something that I concern myself too much about. However, if someone decided that they deemed me worthy to put one of their titles around my waist, I would be absolutely delighted for it, obviously.
Mm-hmm. So for you then, it's a prop, but the meaning of it is a bit more important because it's the trust you're given to at least be on their poster or
exactly
in their record books. As being a champion, that's absolutely fair enough. So, and in 2018, you're back in Target for again a really random match. When I read it, it was yourself, Shady and Trass, of course, one of the mainstays of Target, and from New Japan, Gato Karn.
Yes, who's doing big things as well now.
Yeah, I think he's popped up in New Japan in the US and possibly AEW at some point. Who knows? They have that many folk going through. Yeah. I've no idea at this point.
But I think recently he was doing some stuff with some kind of faction with Will Ospreay and someone else.
Oh, the Empire or something like that.
Yeah.
If it's outside of Scotland, my memory becomes very hazy with details. So I think something like that. So Gato Kharn, of course, works in Japan. So and they've got a very big history of not just like masked guys, but of course the Jushin Thunder Liger and what have you. So we're able to kind of when you have these matches with likes of Shady and Gato Kharn, who've got a bit more experience. Actually, I don't think. Anyway, we're able to kind of pick their brains and find out little bits pieces to your own puzzle. Are you big on match feedback afterwards and getting that feedback from people?
Yeah, I always try. If I'm wrestling with a more experienced guy, I'll always try and get some feedback from him. I like to give a bit of feedback from the refs as well because they've got kind of the closest view of the action. So it's always good to have a ref that knows what he's doing. So he can kind of talk you through any feedback or coaching points. There, one of the good things about GPWA is that anytime there's a kind of a £5 wrestling show or a Wrestling Experience Scotland show, you will have a coach assigned to your match as a producer. So after the match, the coach will sit down with both of you and you've got the match on screen 9 times out of 10. And you'll be able to talk through it both with your opponent and with the coach that was producing the match. So that some of the feedback we can get from that's incredible.
Wow, that's great. It's very definitely different from way back when, and like I said, back to that Tuck of the Draw podcast where Stephen was rightly mentioning when guys like Falcon started and Solar, there was this such a split in factions in Scotland. If you trained at one place, you couldn't train at the other, and all that kind of rubbish, and maybe seeing a match back could have been a rarity. You just had to take whoever was watching it backstage's word for it that this wasn't right and that wasn't right. And now that you're able to sit down, go backstage like 10 minutes afterwards and watch it back and get your feedback straight away, that's absolutely incredible and so beneficial for yourself. So we're up 2018. You've done stuff with big, massive wrestling. Of course, wrestling. You did the Lucha War, which we've established that you're the best lucha in big, massive wrestling. You also had a match with Falcon. Before I moved to past the pandemic stuff, you were also with the Drew Galloway Invitational,
Yes, that's right,
2018. So you're in the first round. Unfortunately, you lost to Damien, who went to the final. Again, now WrestleZone guy that. Otherwise, you probably would have never met unless you went up northeast. What was it like getting chosen for the Drew Galloway Invitational?
It's quite prestigious because there's only a limited amount of spots, and those spots are shared out amongst the whole of the country, really. So initially, the first year it was on, it was the Asylum Invitational. I wasn't part of that. But then with Drew being back in the UK, I don't know if he had went back to WWE at the time or not, but they named it after him as a kind of an honour. So it was quite prestigious. And then when I had been booked to work against Damien, it really piqued my interest because I like to work with people who have a totally different style from me. I watched quite a few of his matches before others. I watched quite a few of his matches just to get a kind of a feel for how he moves and is the kind of what he likes to do. And it was really interesting. I think that we had quite a good clash of styles. I caught a nasty elbow really early on. I caught a back elbow, which burst my nose. My nose seems to burst quite often. I remember bleeding a wee bit in that match, but it was good, and I was, as I say, really happy and delighted to be chosen to represent the GPWA in that tournament.
Like you say, it is prestigious because, of course, it was split between three schools, and then I think it was two. Was it maybe? No, it was two wild cards that year because I think it was Damien and Theodorus was the other one. Yeah, it's quite a big deal. But yeah, so of course, being chosen is probably the best bit about it. And then, but when it comes to like breaking your nose, you say that it seems to happen quite often. Does the mask help or hinder that? Because I suppose it kind of holds everything together, but at the same time, it could maybe make your eyes get a little bit more puffy. I don't know. I've never broken my nose, so I've no idea.
I don't know. I remember when I was wrestling Lionheart, the Zero G match, he super kicked me and I turned into his boot as it was connecting. So there was a wee bit of blood there. Damien with the back out. Yeah, it's just, I don't know. I just seem to turn into strikes with my nose. I'm like, maybe it's a bit big, who knows?
So before we go into other big breaking things, which is why this particular interview was delayed. We'll get to that in a minute. The pandemic hit. So you started wrestling, started 2020, then all shows are off, and that was pretty much it for the year for you. And just about 2 years, actually, because your first match was like July this year. How did you keep yourself occupied? I mean, I suppose if you're doing outdoor boot camps, there would have been some sort of like trepidation what you could and couldn't do, but I suppose you were able to still kind of do something, work.
Yeah, well, the boot camps got kind of the halt put on them for quite a while, maybe 9 months or so, and then they were slowly brought back with a ratio of 5 clients to 1 instructor. And that slowly crept up over the months, and now it's kind of back to the normal standard operating procedure of 30 to 1. But in regards to my own fitness, I bought myself a Wad Sox weighted vest. I bought myself a 20 kilo kettlebell and a 16 kilo kettlebell, and I bought myself some resistance bands as well. And I was putting up workouts on the asylum. We've got a kind of a school Facebook page, well, kind of a secret page or a private page, and I was putting up workouts for the guys to try quite often. So having the good weather out, it helped. I've got quite a decent sized back garden, so I was keeping myself as fit as possible up until July last year. I had my second child was born. So that kind of that kept me on my toes as well. So trying to entertain my oldest, who's now 7, and my youngest, who's now 1, that keeps me fairly active and fairly fit.
That's a pretty good. Again, I'm just going through the amazement of the things that you've got in GPWA, but it must be good having like yourself who can put together all these plans, and you've got guys like Keefe West as well, who's bodybuilding. Yeah. So you've not only got this great kind of state of the art, for lack of a better term, facility, but you've also got all these guys that you've trained with and that are going through the school that have all these skills that they're able to bring. So it must be quite a you must always have something you could do.
We've done quite a lot of Zoom calls, kind of Zoom workouts, just amongst the students. We kind of got together and we've done quite a few Zoom workouts, which was good to keep in touch with the guys as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And of course, you said you regularly train with Sam Barber, who I'm fairly certain he was doing stuff with Joe Hendry around about just before the pandemic hit as well. So it's all finding all these little bits of knowledge along the way and being able to keep in touch with people and still be able to train. When you find out you're getting that wrestling was back and Target was the first place, so I would say outside of GPWA and ICW, I would say Target's probably one of your main haunts for wrestling. So what was it like getting the call that wrestling's back, you're able to come back, and were you ready for it?
100%. I was so ready for it. The promoter, the Target promoter, had messaged me just asking how I was, just to keep in touch. But he was asking, obviously, quite a lot of guys fell away from wrestling due to events that occurred last year. So he was just asking me if I still, it's something that I'm interested in continuing, and just expressing that I'd always be welcome in the Target changing room. So I was delighted. Target, I would now consider Target one of my second homes. It's got a cracking, if anyone up here can get themselves down to Carlisle, it's only about an hour's drive away or so for a show. It's such a talented team of workers and they put on a great show. The teamwork backstage, everyone, there's no kind of wee pockets. Everyone's talking to everyone, everyone's supporting everyone. there's ideas being bounced off every wall. It's phenomenal. It's a really, really good place to work.
And your first match was a tag match with, and it was with Sammy Sparks, who of course another mass wrestler. But I've seen his name pop up in Target results for feels like years, and then finding out he's not even 20 or something like that. He's ridiculously young.
It's unbelievable.
So it must have been like it's like what's news familiar and all that kind of stuff. So you're back in the wrestling, but you're still in this mass tag team, and it's kind of like this is familiar as well as getting back in the wrestling. So wrestling with Sammy, was he able to, were you now the veteran and being able to pass on your knowledge how to do little bits and pieces with your face and your body movements for Sammy?
I think Sammy's wrestled probably not quite as long as me, but he's wrestled for quite a number of years, as young as he is. He does some high level stuff. He's really good at what he does. His crowd work's really good. I think that's something Target work on quite a lot, because they've quite a kind of family oriented show. So the kind of the crowd work's there. He knows what he does, and he doesn't try and deviate from that, which is good. It's not kind of, because a lot of guys you'll get maybe try something on a show that they've never tried before, which is probably not a great idea unless you've tried it in a training ring or something. But Sammy's not one. He'll if he wants to try something out, he'll do it until he nails it in training before we bring it into the ring, which is really good. But I've got quite a good relationship now with Sammy. I've talked to him quite a bit. He's awesome. He's one to watch.
It's one of those, as soon as you, again, I keep bringing up Rey Mysterio for obvious reasons, but it's one of those things where, of course, you're a mask guy, you're always going to get shouted to do a 6Y9 or something, and if you can't do it, don't, because it looks a lot harder than you think.
Oh, yeah. The first time I tried a 6Y9, rather than catch the rope with my hands, I caught it under my arms and ended up with terrible rope burn underneath my armpit. It was horrendous.
Yeah, so he makes it look easy.
Yeah.
But it's one of those, I still don't understand the whole physics of it, because at one minute you've got your hands and the ropes, this is going to be an awful first screen grabs, hands on the ropes there, and then next second your hands are somewhere else, and it's, like I say, never going to be wrestling myself, and I don't need to think about it too much. And the other thing that during that interim, so you had Target Wrestling, which you say you feel like is now your second home. You're also announced to be in Pro 2.
Yes, that is an exciting project.
And Logan Storm is very passionate. And was that a case of you putting a CV to him, or did he come to you? Because I know he's an ideas guy. He comes with that. He's already got a plan for you. If he's booking you, he's got a plan. So it's yourself and Lucha DS as a team for the No Guts, No Glory tournament. But did he approach you and go, right, I've got this idea, guys, and that's it?
Well, the first thing that when he announced it, Big John Irvin was running the match. Was it the match day manager or the match day commissioner or something? I sent him a message because I know John. I know John from, John used to work at the Pro Wrestling Elite shows. So I sent him a message and he said, well, actually, I've had a conversation about you. So your name is in the mix. And then the next thing, I got a message from Logan Storm. So I sent him some bits and bobs over, and the rest, as they say, is history. I was brought on board from there. The graphic was up.
With the infamous, did you get the infamous "Are you pro too?" at the end? I keep hearing this. I've never received it myself. So
I did. I did.
I love that. I absolutely love that. So that's quite a good lot in the future. And of course, right now, wrestling's not happening for you because of a broken collarbone.
Yep.
Wrestling related or just a pure freak accident?
A bit of an idiot, to be fair. I was up on an adventure weekend with the boot camp company that I worked for. So we went up to Aviemore. So we done some stand-up paddle boarding, we done a bit of kind of Monroe bagging, and then we went mountain biking. So it was kind of the high of the bike, and then there's a really nice 16K or 16-mile loop. But there's different grades to this loop, so there's obstacles all around it. The black obstacles are the most difficult ones, and they're deemed to be for elite mountain biking athletes. So it turns out I'm not an elite mountain biking athlete. So I landed pretty much every single jump on the course. I landed right until the last one, which was a double jump. I had done the first one and I was already committed. I hit the ground, and the girl behind me, she was one of our group, she said, I hit the ground and went, oh, no, that was a bad one. So I got up, hobbled over to the seat with a bit of help, and I sat there for an hour waiting for an ambulance. And then I sat in the back of the ambulance for an hour up to Elgin.
Hey!
Exactly, I was in, is it Dr. Someone's hospital?
Dr. Gray's, who would have been there?
Dr. Gray's, that's the one. Where they sent me away with some painkillers and a triangular bandage.
That sounds about right.
They told me it is broken, the x-rayed it, so it was quite a bad break. It's kind of broken in two or three different places. Sent me home to tell me to go to the fracture clinic in Glasgow. So I done that, and then the fracture clinic guy said, the doctor said to me, right, you need surgery tomorrow. Okay. So I got, I had surgery 2 weeks ago today. So I had a steel plate, a titanium plate installed, and 8 titanium screws. I'll give you a wee. See the wee scar there?
It's impressive.
Quite nasty, right along the whole length of the collarbone.
If that's good, you could have done the interview from your hostel bed, just when you're bounced off your I can't swear my own podcast, off your mind on painkillers. That would have been
entertaining. Hydrocodone, yeah, that'd have been fun.
But no, yeah, that's I've been left there with the whole breakages and Dr. Gray's. Dr. Gray's a special place. For many reasons, but you know, that's such a small world weirdness that they end up. We were in the same town briefly. One was a lot more. One was in a bit less pieces than you would have hoped to be.
Yeah.
So of course that set back the whole wrestling thing. The whole you're not quite pro two at the moment. You seem to be moving about your arms, your shoulders quite well. So is it a case of just slowly getting the rehab and starting? If you already kind of got a plan together that you're kind of implementing to get that strength back up?
I've been rehabbing it quite a bit myself, just with body weight movements, nothing too much. I had physio yesterday. I had a checkup, and the doctor, the physio, was quite surprised at how mobile I was. She said to me, I was still quite away from being back in the gym. She asked if I do anything, any contact sports. Said that I'm a professional wrestler. She said that's quite a far bit in the distance. However, I'll decide that. She also said there'd be a checkup in 6 weeks' time whether she'd deem me fit to drive or not. I had drove to the appointment, so so I think I'm not sure I'll stick to that schedule. I'm not going to rush back. I don't want to injure it again. However, I do have a plan in place to be back kind of bigger, stronger, and better than I was before.
Mm-hmm. I definitely know for myself that when I've had breakages, I had the one, but it was in three places. It was quite spectacular. It was kind of the same. You can't drive, and I was like, I can drive fine. And then I changed gear because I broke my elbow. So I changed gear, and my elbow just seized, and I was like, oh no. Thankfully, my partner at the time, my wife, she's a partner at the time, now she's my wife, she was in the car next to me, so she could do the gear. Mm-hmm. And we got to a point where I could just get out the car and swap over, because I can't even put the car in reverse now. So you need to get in there. But it's sometimes you have to listen to the doctors. So as long as you don't push, as long as you don't push yourself too hard and know your own limits, you'll be fine. You'll be pro two before you know it. Before we kind of wrap up, I've got a couple questions that we ask everyone. Stupid questions that we ask, but they're somehow a staple of this podcast. What's your favourite dinosaur?
Velociraptor.
I could tell you're a Velociraptor kind of person. I don't know why. Just the quick movements, all that kind of stuff. Could pick that one. And another question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, 2 sheep or 1 cow?
A cow, hands down.
Confidence, I'm not going to ask any further. That's fine. So before we wrap up and do all the social media plugs and plug your merch and what have you, is there any dream opponents that you've got in the near future that you want to get in the ring with? I don't know if you've wrestled BT Gunn, but is he kind of one of the last few coaches that you've got to get in the ring with?
Yeah, absolutely. I would love... BT Gunn has said a few times that he's got a kind of psycho clown luchador mask that he would love to wear in a match against me, kind of lucha style. So that's got to be up there, one of the dream matches.
I've definitely got to be a little bit more better and rehabbed, because you're not wanting a chop anywhere near that scar at this moment in time.
It's a titanium plate underneath it, so maybe his hand at the top more than my arm.
There we go. That's the old Lex Luger forearm plate. There we go. That's a story in itself. Excellent. So yeah, BT Gunn, anyone else that's out there that you want to get in the ring with, say in the next, I don't know, 5 years, any dream opponents?
I would love to work. There's loads. Guys that are right up there. I done a training seminar a few years ago with Pete Dunn, and I love everything that he does. His movement, spectacular. The shape that he's got himself in is phenomenal. Don't know how he's done it being a vegan, but fair play to him. Wolfie had a really, really good series of matches years ago with Sola, and I think we'd be able to capture some of that with him. I think I'm a fair bit bigger than Sola was back then, but that kind of big guy, wee guy match would be really, really good with Wolfie.
Wonderful. So yeah, that's I think. And is there any promotions at all as well? So you said Target's kind of your home, and of course you wrestled regularly and the wrestling experience Scotland's coming back and what have you. But is there any promotions that you want to get to soon?
As I say, I'd love to wrestle up in WrestleZone. I've got I'm going down south for UCW next year, April. I'll be down at UCW, which is already in the diary. So that's the first one in the diary post injury. But I'm hoping to be back at Target before then as well. Discovery, when they come back, I'd love to get back involved with Discovery, because as I say, I think that's going to be the place to be in 2022 in Scotland, but in the UK as a whole.
Absolutely. I'm already trying to figure it. I'm trying to plan a trip to Edinburgh when they've got their 2022 dates and finally get to a disco show, because I've never been, because I'm, as you know, I'm up way north now. I'm in Elgin, so it's a little bit more difficult to get to shows. But if you're up to WrestleZone, I'll probably be one of the front couple rows anyway, so I'll hopefully see you there. But yes. Yeah, so as we wrap up, where can people find you? Where can people get your merch? Plug all your stuff.
Yeah, okie dokie. I can be found on all socials, so that's Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and it's at Soldato GPWA. And I've got a big cartel store, and that is, I think that's Soldato GPWA as well. If it's not, then the links to it are on my Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
I've got it right in front of me. So yeah, soldato.bigcartel.com. It's in your profile. Great. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me today. And it's been a... Oh, I would have one question. We did get one question in. It was from Lucha DS. Seems like a good one to end on. I just say, ask him when me and him are going to get drunk again.
When we can both get babysitters for the night.
There you go. That's the best way to end it. But great. Thank you very much for speaking to me.
Smashing. Thank you very much, Billy.